So next up, we've got our second speaker lined up already, and my colleague Antonia is going to introduce our next speaker. So listen in, everybody. Thank you for your time so far.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you, Hasana. My name is Antonia Alanieva, and I'm a QLM for CIOB London and South. Thank you to all the contributors so far, and I look forward to an exciting day ahead of us. I would like to welcome to the stage our next speaker, Whitney Bevan, Dr. Whitney Bevan, who must really feel at home with CIOB now due to her regular contribution at CIOB events. So Whitney is a lecturer in construction management at the Scott Sutherland School of Architecture and Built Environment at Robert Gordon University. Whitney is motivated to create an environment where students are encouraged to be innovative, creative, and thinking, curious as to how classroom theory works in practice and how the opportunity to discover what ignites their passion within the construction industry. Whitney's research and key interests around sustainability within the built environments, skills for the construction workforce, low carbon building delivery, and sustainable healthy communities. Whitney has previous experience working at Western Sydney University, Australia, and started her academic career at the University of Reading. Whitney's enthusiasm and promotion for well-being extends beyond working hours, as she is a keen ultra runner, fitness instructor, and nutritional health coach. Whitney will now run us through a top tips on dissertation, and I would encourage you all to put your burning questions to that chat box for us during her talk. I have no doubt this will be very topical. So over to you, Whitney. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Antonia. Can you hear me and can you see my screen?
We can.
Yes. Okay. Oh, brilliant. Thank you so much for that lovely introduction and also for having me here this morning. Yes, I do feel quite at home actually here. So I'm hoping that today students will get some tips for dissertations. You might be just starting your dissertation. You might be coming, towards the end. You might be thinking about it for the next year or so. These are more my tips that I've learned myself doing dissertations, doing research projects, but also, I've had a number of students over the years, undergrad, postgrad, also doing their research. So I've picked up hopefully some tips for them in terms of how they think about their research that should maybe resonate with some of you and help you along the way. So I started with this quote. I've stolen it from somebody else. I think this resonates with me because of that's basically what research is about, a little bit of maybe uncertainty in an area, maybe not huge, but there's that uncertainty there, but it's also that opportunity to research it, to find out more about it. Brilliant. So this is me. I've used this of me when I'm out collecting data. This is my favorite part of it. I love where I can see the impact or the curiosity come to life. You might have in your journey your favorite bits, but collecting data is where it comes interesting for me. So I always say to my students, make sure you get that first part, your aims and objectives correct, and then when you go out to collect data, that sort of uplifts you a little bit. Can I have the next slide, please? Possibly to help you a little bit and maybe motivate you if we're getting started on your dissertation, I find it helps to talk about what I gained. Yes, it's research. So I certainly got to the knowledge of how to conduct research, how to conduct a robust research project. I learned how to write academically and professionally. Yes, you'll be learning how to write reports and doing your assessments, but that sort of hones in on it. It's a lot more words, but also it's a lot more learning. And I am constantly, I'd say to all my students, I'm constantly learning how to write academically and professionally. That is a big journey that you'll go through. It never comes to an end point. Communication skills is a big one for me. I learned when I'm talking to maybe my interviewees, or I'm asking about documentation. That was a big one for me, how to communicate effectively and also how to listen to what people are saying when I'm collecting my data. Built my network. I worked with, during my dissertations, during my PhD, I worked with local authority. I worked with an organization for my undergrad dissertation. I really built my network. Those people are still part of my network now. I do still call them up and ask about certain PV panels, etc. So renewables in buildings. Time management, probably the biggest one, something that I am not the best at. That's not my strong point. But I'm sure that during my dissertations, that really helped me to understand why time management is important. So that's why we say to start early with your dissertation in terms of your planning. And that will really help you to plan your time. I think the biggest time management one we want to think about is data collection. Make sure you have a cutoff point for your data collection, because you really need to have time to analyze, to write up all that other stuff, and that you have your end point. So know when you're going to hand it in, and have your points, just like my project managers will do their program or their Gantt chart. Have something like that with your key milestones as you go throughout. Can I have the next slide, please? So what I'm going to do today is I'm going to take you briefly through some of the key sections, not some of them, all the key sections. Dissertations will be slightly different in terms of your topic. People might split up their chapters differently, but I'm going to sort of give you the key ingredients of those chapters. So introduction, normally your chapter one. It sets the scene. That's why I say it's all the chapters are important. I'll probably say for every section, this is the most important chapter, but this is important because it sets the scene. So find your background, find what drives that problem. So what is the problem that you're investigating? And it's sort of like building your straw man. So you're giving the reader the problem. I normally say, if you're looking for funding money for research, this is where you'll get it from, your problem. You're explaining to the reader in this section and your literature review the need for you to go out and do that. So if I'm asking for money for my research, I'm giving them those ideas as to why I need to go out and do it. What makes your research novel? Ask yourself. For me, it might be I do a lot of in terms of skills and low carbon technologies. The novelty for mine was that there's a lot of people talking about the skills you need. What was novel was that there's very little in terms of how we get those skills. So you're pointing that out to the reader. Really important, that's why I put it in red, is your aims and objectives. They need to be crystal clear before you go and collect data, before or within that literature as well. As you're reading, then find your aims and objectives, then using that literature that's in line with your aims and objectives. And also if you're thinking about how you collect data, you need to be thinking about in line with aims and objectives. So they need to be crystal clear before you get, before you take your investigation further. So they are the foundations, really, your aims and objectives. I'm sure your supervisor will talk about them at the start more than anything. So get that introduction with the clear, what is the problem that leads down to the need for you to collect data around your aims and objectives. Next slide. Literature review, so your chapter two. This is something for me that starts at the very start, but goes right the way throughout, right up until write-up. Why conduct a literature review? We're thinking about why we need to understand current, previous investigations on the subject. One, so that we don't know, so they don't actually do the same thing. So there's no point in doing the exact same investigation as someone else. But also it's the literature that informs us of where to go. So what else? And we do use that word gap in terms of what is missing within that literature that you could add to, and that is very small. I think a lot of students feel like they need something significant to add to, but it's very tiny. And for me, it was just that little bit more about how to get the skills. Be careful of trying not to say anything too negative. We want to be critical, and that's what I mean by critical, in terms of a lot of value from what other people have done on this topic, but what would be interesting, of value, would be to really understand a little bit more. And then, of course, it comes down to that's what I'm going to do. Sources, make sure they're quality sources. So things like your journal articles where people have actually gone out and done investigations before. So similar to your investigation, that's what we want in literature review. Quality reports, quality web pages, make sure they've got an author and a date. Make sure that you're thinking close to your topic and close to your subjects or real similar, so nothing off the topic. I think what I normally find that I do, I need to have my aims objectives next to me, next to my laptop or on a post-it note, because I'll read one journal article that will be on the topic, but they might go further into other things or comment on other findings that I think, oh, that's interesting, and I'll go off on a tangent. So always have your aims and objectives there when you're thinking about it. What we're looking at is similar investigations. And always at the end of my literature review, what I normally like to do is, as well as throughout, I compare, comment and contrast. So what is similar on the subject? And what have people talked about in terms of their findings that, you know, they say similar things. So for example, barriers to sustainable technology in buildings. There might be one subsection on cost, there might be one subsection on awareness, and where people have said similar things. There might also be contrasting views within the literature. So maybe one person or a few journal articles might say where they've gone out investigating cost has come up as the dominant barrier, but then other people might have gone out and thought that actually the technology itself is the dominant barrier. So that's where it all comes to life in your literature review. It's fine if they have similarities, it's fine if they have difference in opinions. Try to avoid making it a summary. It's not a summary. I think the thing you want to avoid is saying, this person did this and says this, this person did this and says this. So try and avoid that. At the end, I have that paragraph that normally brings out the key points from the literature. So what do you want the reader to remember? And you want to give that argument that you need to go and do your research. Next slide, please. I've taken this quite an old reference, but I think it explains literature review nicely in terms of it's not just writing a summary, it's that critical eye on what other people have done. Be careful not to be too critical in terms of saying that they didn't go do this, they didn't go do that, because they probably didn't go and set out and say they were going to do that. But what they did was of value, but it would be really good to know a little bit more about this. Just like when you read articles, and at the end of the articles, after their key findings, they normally talk about areas of further research. And they put in, you know, if we had more time, we'd want to do this. And that's sort of what you're saying. But what you're saying is what we do need to do is what I'm going to do, in so many words. So you're, again, building your strong man towards the end of your literature review. Building bridges. So thinking about where people have said similar things. Maybe you're building that bridge between two people doing your investigation. And also thinking about central issues within the field. Next slide. Be careful. You cannot cover every investigation in your literature review, and that's why I can't say nobody has ever studied how to gain skills or how to gain green skills. I can say that there appears to be very little research in this area. And just keep your compare, comment, contrast next to you when you're thinking about your literature review, and that will get you out of creating a summary. Next slide. And think before you, when you come down to the end of that literature review, think, has it said to me, I want to turn the page to see how the problem is going to be resolved? And of course, that's the reader. That's them reading your literature review and thinking, yeah, there are all these different arguments. Or there is something missing that really would be of value to the construction industry or to the industry or to people working that would really help. And of course, you're going to turn the page onto your methodology and you're going to tell them what you did. Next slide, please. Methodology, your methods section. research design and data collection, approach to your research, research analysis. It's really about what you did and why you did it. And are you able to justify it? So one of the things I keep in mind when I'm writing my methods is when people will ask you, and I think this would normally come up when you talk about all the different research methods, people will say, well, why didn't you use this method and why didn't you use that method? But you've got to flip it on the other way and you've got to say, well, I use this method because of this. So it's about choosing your appropriate one. It's not about defending why you didn't use all the others, but it's about that good research or that robust research will have chosen the appropriate method to answer your aims and objectives for your research. So for example, if I'm asking people, how did you gain this type of training? Or if I'm trying to find out the types of training that's needed for green skills, there's no good me going out and doing an experiment. There's probably also no good me going out if I'm asking that question and doing a questionnaire with closed questions with yes or no's. For me, I went and did interviews. I want to get that rich quality perceptions and explanations of the individual skills and also insight on the types of training. I also didn't know different types of training. So that is why I went and done that semi-structured interview to allow the interviewee to really expand on things. Ethics are really important. I'm sure you'll talk about that with your supervisor. That really ensures that there's consent and that it protects you and your participants who's involved. So that's just an example. With your permission, the interview would be transcribed. That's the example of a consent form I would give before I collect interviews or data with my interviewees or my participants. Try not to make the mistake of covering everything you didn't use. As a good researcher, you're not going to know every method under the sun, but you're going to know why you did that. And that is all about the justification. So try to avoid, I did this and this, we did this, blah, 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 I did this, or this investigation adopted this method. Yes, put that, but then go on to talk about why. Because a good researcher will know that every method has limitations and benefits to use for their investigation. And this is just an example of where we're looking at literature. You're making sure that those keywords are on your topic to make sure that when you're writing a literature review, which again, you'll talk about in your methodology in terms of how you actually did that, you're making sure that you're sticking to that topic. Next slide, please. Just a bit of data analysis. So I normally find my methodology, and this is not a must, my methods I normally split into research approach. So before I got out there and collected data, what was my approach? Data collection and research methods, how I did it, how I actually went out into the field and did it, and then data analysis. So when I've collected my data, how do I ensure that is in line with my aims, objectives, and that's your data analysis. Next slide, please. Results and discussion. So the next chapter, some people will put this in just chapter results and some people will put it in just as a chapter as in discussion. I like them both together because when I talk about my results, I love to discuss them. I love to get right in there and discuss them with my aims and objectives. It might be the case where you have maybe a lot of data. Hopefully you haven't got over your time and you've had that time cut off. But it might be fine where you have a lot of data. Now, when I get into interviews, yes, they'll answer my questions, but they might go off and talk about other things. It's me as a researcher to get them back onto my topic. But they might go off and talk about maybe other types of technology or other types of skills that they have, which is brilliant. But I'll sway them back in towards the conversation around my aims and objectives and what I'm asking. But that might also be interesting to you. And what I have to stop myself doing is ensuring that when I come back to my data analysis, that I don't go off my aims and objectives. So again, I would say have your aims and objectives there. It's very interesting stuff, but is it what you're doing in your research investigation? And this is an example of my skills. Again, next to my aims, objectives, thinking about the type of skills, but also training. Next slide, please. Conclusions. So your last chapter, nothing new. So nothing new in terms of any surprises in terms of your results. All your results and discussion will be that chapter before. Also should have mentioned on your results and discussion that there's nothing wrong, I had this question last week, there's nothing wrong with your results and discussion being different to the literature. So for example, in terms of barriers to renewable technology, it might be that somebody has talked about a barrier in my interviews that was different to what I found in the literature. That's adding, that's contribution. That's extending the literature a little bit. It might be more information on one of the barriers that I didn't find. There's nothing wrong with that. So in your discussion part, maybe bring back in some of that literature to just emphasize how it's added to it, enhanced it, you know, being different to it. There's absolutely nothing wrong with that. In your conclusions, think about what was the key, what you want to read, what you want to leave the reader with, just like we did in our literature review at that very end, that last paragraph. What you want to leave the reader with in terms of your aims and objectives, what you found. Always good to think about contributions. So where you will have contributed to theory, so where you've maybe enhanced, extended the literature from your work. For example, thinking about types of training, thinking about different types of skills, thinking about different barriers, whatever your topic is. Adding to practice, or contribution to practice, would normally say if there was someone from industry, so maybe, I don't know, let's take a project manager, and I was talking about their skills, what would I need to say to them in terms of how they get those skills that they are required or that they need. So it's really taking your results and giving them to the broader, maybe construction industry or your sector. And again, it's thinking about that sort of hourglass shape of your dissertation, thinking about that initial start when it's more broad, it's still very defined to the topic. So for example, if I'm talking about renewables in buildings, I might be starting off with the fact that we need to be thinking about reducing our emissions in buildings, or we need to be thinking about reducing emissions. The construction sector, again, one of the largest emitters. So that's what we need to think about. One of the ways in which we can do this is residential buildings. So that's my more broader aspect. It then comes down to my aims and objectives, very narrow defined, narrow onto those types of literature, the topic. Then what I did, then coming back out to weigh my results, add to the broader construction industry. You may also contribute to methodology if you come up with any new methods in terms of frameworks, models, data collection, etc. And this is just an example of where my results, where I would have talked about this in my last chapter, my results and discussion, and how I would have added to theory. So they're talking about what a technical skill actually is. So where there was, you know, there was definitions of technical skills for green buildings or sustainable buildings in the literature. They talk about all of that, but where I could maybe add to it a little bit was what this local authority energy system was talking about. And then this is probably my addition to practice, or my contribution to practice. I would have talked about this in my results section, where I would have said, you know, this was my key finding, explained what it means, and also explained how it might add to practice then in my conclusions. Next slide, please. References, everyone's favorite. I would say get references right as soon as you can. I think references are black and white, they're either right or wrong. So make sure you maybe print out how to reference fully a book, a journal article, a publication, a website. That never changes. Make sure it's in line with your university. So for us here, we do RGU Harvard referencing. So check your university guidelines, check on the library, and check what you need. Quality references are really important. I normally say if they haven't got an author or you, especially if they haven't got an author, then they're probably not quality. If I did a piece of work, I would want my name on it. So be careful of that. Try not to reference a reference. So if you're reading something, maybe a journal article, and somebody say in the work by Tigme Bevan, had described this and gave these results, go to actual that work. So go to the reference by Bevan, look at the reference and read it. Because what you're doing when you reference a reference is actually referencing someone else's interpretation of that reference. So go to the original and find that. Full reference in your reference list towards the end or at the end. Have a look at where they were published. Make sure you've got all that information in that full reference. And then whatever you got in your main body, in your all your chapters, make sure that matches up with the full reference list. And same for the full reference list. Whatever's in the full reference list, make sure you got them in terms of your author year or author year and page number if you're direct quoting in your chapters. Next slide, please. And just lastly, to finish off, advice that I would give, and this is just my advice, my little bits of gold that's really helped me along. Remember that secondary data can be just as good as primary data. I feel like a lot of students, when they come to me, say that they need to collect so much data. Not the case. It wouldn't be great if you collected so much primary data, if you did 10 interviews and then didn't have time to analyze it or write up. So think about that dissertation as a whole. That's what's really important. Tell the story. Make the story interesting from start to finish. You can have a really good investigation that's secondary data, because it's about using the correct methods to analyze it. It's about that secondary data that can answer your aim's objectives. I could have collected a lot of primary data, but have I analyzed it with my aim's objectives? That's what's really important. Dissertation is all about being a good researcher. So think about some of these things that you would put in place that demonstrates that you can be a good researcher. It's the research process that counts. A lot of people think that they have to get this thesis, this book, towards the end of it. Yes, you do. That has to show and has to explain and demonstrate your research project, what you carried out, what you found, areas of further research, all of that stuff. But also you'll be learning all of these other skills as you go through it. I think for me, time management and communication was my two biggest skills. I'm still working on that writing. But they were the biggest things that really helped me to expand on those skills. Yeah, they were okay, but really honed in to really enhance them. Tell the story, make it interesting, bring your investigation to life. If you've got images, obviously reference them. If you've got images of anything in terms of your data collection, you need to get that consent before you use it. But if you have images, if you have tables, if you have figures, bring your story to life. You want to show in that thesis, in your dissertation, that investigation that you carried out. That's really what you're doing. And just the last slide, please. Best advice I was given is to take a break, is to reset, to come back to your work. A lot of my dissertations I would be clutching because I need to be with them all the time. It really helps to get that break. You come back to your work, I promise you, you're refreshed. My thing is I normally used to go back to Wales when I was at Reading. And just that away from the dissertation work bubble, into the bubble of my family and that chaos and everything else going on in everyday life, helped me to reset, to come back with a fresh head. And I'd normally read it and think, I need to actually change that. So do whatever you need to do. That might be a coffee, that might be a break, that might be an hour break, just an hour, that might be a walk. But I can promise you it will absolutely help when you're in that bubble of dissertation. Get back out there into the bubble of life for a bit, and it will just help to reset. It's also, you know, mentally draining. If you're constantly with your dissertation, a fresh perspective really does help. I hope that these tips have helped, and anything that I can help with, any questions, please let me know.
Thank you, Dr. Whitney. We are slightly over time now, and we will sure take your idea of taking a break soon. But would you just have one more question for you, if you could answer that for us quickly? It's from Gideon Adeyanju, if I pronounce that right, sorry. He asked, or she asked, Dr. Whitney, how do you prioritize and allocate your time during the dissertation writing process? And what strategies do you use to ensure that you are able to complete your research, analysis, and writing within the allocated time frame? I have discovered that the time is a key factor in research.
Yes, absolutely. And I think, like I said, my time management is never the best. So I'm always learning how to get better at that. And also tell my project managers also to get better at that with me. I would say know your deadline. So know the day that it needs to be handed in. I would give norm yourself, if you can, 5 days to do the editing. So the last part, the putting, you know, your reference list together, checking the reference, checking it in the reference list, looking at the citations around your tables, you know, table one, figure one, etc. All of that stuff, give yourself 5 days towards the end. So take 5 days off that, because we always run in a few days over. Like I said, have those cutoff points. So your introduction and your literature, as long as your aims and objectives there and the problem, your introduction and literature can keep going on throughout. They can be keep being updated. I would make sure you have a cutoff time that's enough time to do your data analysis and your write-up. Think about if you're transcribing interviews, that can take a while. So have that cutoff point for data collection. And have your drafts of your chapters, I would. I also think having a draft, even if it's not complete, it's not going to be complete until maybe that write-up stage. But as you're going through your methodology, you might just want to structure it. So I would put maybe research design and data collection. I might write a few sentences about what I did as I'm doing it. That will also take the pressure off. I also have, maybe I might have 5 different Word documents on my desktop that will be introduction, literature, methods, results and discussion and conclusions. And as I maybe reading things to put in my literature and putting them in, that really eases the pressure to write up as well, because, you know, if we delay stuff, we just delay and delay, but we're constantly thinking about it. So I'd have that write up, but I'd also have your deadlines in terms of when chapter 3 needs to be roughly complete, when your methodology needs to be complete, when you need to start structuring, or maybe even start to think about your results and discussions. That helps. And then also having a break and coming to it. I think the worst thing you could do is say that you're going to write it all up in a few days. That's not going to happen. A lot of my students think that I can just write things and put it down and it be right first time. Never happens. Never happens. I don't know anybody that actually does that. So make sure you give yourself time to do that drafting, to come back, to make changes when it's actually on the paper. Get stuff that's in your head on paper as soon as you can. Hopefully that helps.
Thank you very much. I hope that did answer. So thank you, Dr. Whitney, for your excellent input. I'm sure our guests would have found it very helpful. So dissertations can be hard work. We will now take a short break, and well-deserved break for a few minutes. We will be back here at 11:30 for more exciting topics and to welcome our next speaker. So have a nice break.
Thanks, Antonia. Bye-bye.
Thank you.